This video is sponsored by World of Warships. It's often said that the mark of a first-rate navy is to have at least one functional aircraft carrier. But in a frank assessment, having just one is never enough for any wealthy country with a significant coastline. With that in mind, during their heyday through World War II to the end of the Cold War, NATO and the USSR operated dozens. This was so both factions could respond to threats wherever they materialized across the globe, and no class of aircraft carrier was as widely built or operated as the American Essex-class, with the USS Leyte being perhaps most of note. And although this imposing vessel patrolled the seas in peace and war from 1946 to 1970, few know what ultimately became of her, as she was unceremoniously scrapped. Stay tuned to find out why, as today we uncover the forgotten history of the USS Leyte. I'm your host, Ryan Socash, and you're watching It's History. Perhaps nothing captivates the imagination like a massive lost aircraft carrier, but if you're looking to bring these forgotten ships back to life in a more meaningful way, check out the sponsor of this episode, World of Warships. This free-to-play PC game is effectively a floating digital museum with epic recreations of not just the most fearsome vessels of the First and Second World Wars, but also many blueprints and designs of ships that never saw battle. New content is released every month, whether it's new ships, in-game nations, cosmetics, or even ship classes, which means there's always something new to discover. The graphics are incredibly good, with over 40 unique maps featuring dynamic weather and stunning updates for new water effects and textures. In my opinion, these features make the game's seas virtually indistinguishable from the real deal. Additionally, World of Warships has a passionate and dedicated fan base to connect with by joining the action in-game. Participate in discussions on the World of Warships official Discord server, tune into live streams, or participate in tournaments. This game is also available on consoles, so don't miss out on the perfect strategic game to take your mind off things. Download World of Warships using my link in the description. Use the code WARSHIPS during registration to get exclusive rewards, including a bunch of doubloons, credits, premium account time, and a free ship after you complete 15 battles. USS Leyte was laid down in February 1944 under the original name Crown Point. She was part of the Ticonderoga subclass, otherwise known as the Essex Longhulls. These ships were slightly longer and had improved hull designs to deal with the Pacific storm seasons, while increasing armor around the Combat Information Center and fuel and ammunition stowage. During Crown Point's construction, the American Army launched the landings on the Japanese-held Philippines, landing in Leyte Gulf, to General MacArthur's famous words, "I have returned." This marked a major action in the war, retaliating against the Japanese one more time for the defeat of the American Army at Bataan 2 years prior. The invasion was so major that Crown Point was renamed after the battle, the third American warship to bear the name Leyte. Still, despite every design and industrial improvement, American shipbuilders had made the Essex design. She was a massive ship, weighing in at 27,100 long tons when she was launched on August 23, 1945. 3 days later, the USS Missouri entered Tokyo Bay under massive sea, an air escort, and accepted the unconditional surrender of the Empire of Japan. The Leyte was so close to completion. However, the choice was made to finish her construction and fitting out, allowing her to join the fleet on April the 11th, 1946. She found herself as one of the crowning achievements in the largest navy on Earth. A ship launched so close to the surrender of Japan, it was almost uncanny. But her first few years were spent at peace, patrolling the North and South Atlantic, becoming one of the first American carriers equipped with Sikorsky H-5 naval helicopters in 1948. But her career would not be one of peace, as she would serve her purpose during the Korean War. The early days of the Cold War were a much different and more aggressive monster than from the 60s onwards. The post-war balance and boundaries were continuous everywhere, and while Germany's partitioning got plenty of attention during this period, the split between North and South Korea was where the first shots of the Cold War were fired. On June the 25th, 1950, supported by the Soviet Union and Communist China, the Kim regime of North Korea crossed the 38th parallel and invaded South Korea. American and South Korean forces were whipped into retreat, and the Korean War began, thanks frankly to a political farce that kept the USSR and Communist China from voting in the UN Security Council around this time. The UN massively voted in favor of military intervention to restore the South Korean border. And so it was. An American-led military coalition prepared itself for Korea and left for the war that brought the capitalist and communist bloc the closest to total war. Leyte arrived in Sasebo, Japan that October on the 8th with the Allied fleet and performed joint combat training before joining Task Force 77. On November the 5th, she departed for Korea with her battleship Missouri, her sister ships Philippine Sea and Valley Forge, and the anti-air cruiser Juno. She began combat operations the next day. 36 combat sorties were launched over two regions of North Korea. On the next day, her air wing flew a 91 strike mission, air patrol, and photo reconnaissance flights, and another 96 the next day. This rapid pace would continue day after day to protect the American, UN, and South Korean armies during the massive counteroffensive under General MacArthur's command. On the 11th, either from the ground fire or from mechanical defect, Lieutenant R.R. Batson from the Leyte was forced to crash land his plane during the combat mission. Although his squad mates saw him safely evacuate the plane, rescue operations for the rest of the month were inconclusive. Another pilot, Ensign W.G. Wagner, crash-landed later that month and was unsuccessfully rescued by helicopter. But November was not a month for bad news aboard the ship. On the 18th, they encountered something completely new to them. At least two MiG-23 jet fighters, probably Chinese, flying over North Korea. Using her own F-9F Panther fighter jets, one was successfully destroyed, and the other escaped despite taking damage. For the rest of November, Leyte's airmen flew 926 combat missions in the face of enemy jets, anti-aircraft, and a pounding North Pacific winter. She would protect the Marines at the chosen reservoir even after they were encircled by the Chinese army. Now, for some quick context, I'd like you to imagine the Sea of Japan as it is between Korea and the Japanese archipelago. You might think, as it's somewhat sheltered by the island and the continent, it's somewhat calm. Well, no, at least it wasn't during that winter. The fact is that this winter was up there with the worst of them. The North Pacific had a miserable winter for everyone in 1950, and the temperatures in the chosen reservoir reached minus 70 degrees Fahrenheit, accounting for wind chill. Military operations should have been impossible, with even the best supplied UN units suffering from frostbite and camp diseases. Meanwhile, the state of the much more poorly supplied and equipped Chinese army is best not to think about. At sea, carriers were constantly fighting ice on their flight decks and brutally choppy weather that could toss even those mighty ships like bath toys. For that reason, flights regularly had to abort landings on their motherships and find a land base in friendly territory instead. As the captain wrote in his log, quote, "Snow and ice on the flight deck was experienced several times and required extreme caution by pilots and flight deck crews to prevent personnel and aircraft casualties." The F-9F Banshee aircraft, with wings folded, is very unstable and on an icy flight deck must be securely tied down with wire to prevent the plane and chocks from sliding across the deck in a turn or a crosswind. With the Chinese army now involved in the war, flights took on entirely different character. Every report in the ship's log from the start of December onwards, when air operations were possible, reads, quote, "Continued maximum effort, close support mansion in the chosen reservoir, until the 10th, when the Marine Corps' 1st Division successfully evacuated south." The numbers are pretty amazing when you see more than a dozen aircraft from the Leyte that would be used for air support in the chosen reservoir before the retreat and area security around Hongneng. It was during this battle to relieve the Marines at Chosin that Ensign Jess Leroy Brown was engaged by air defenses on December the 4th and forced to crash land his F4U. His wingman Thomas Hunter crashed his plane close by to attempt to rescue him with the aid of a helicopter rescue team. Despite their best efforts, Brown died, still pinned into his cockpit, and could not be rescued. The helicopter team made sure Hunter did evacuate, returning him to the mothership without his wingman. Leyte, per the December log, read, quote, "Attacked over 152 troop emplacements, it is estimated that 8,000 to 10,000 casualties were inflicted. 1,824 bodies were counted from the air. After an accuracy check with ground force estimates, an initial count was later confirmed by ground to be 2,000 killed." Overall, before returning to Japan for rest, the USS Leyte was assessed to have been of slightly greater benefit to ground forces and air support and patrol than her sisters, Philippine Sea and Valley Forge. Leyte had the three smallest air wings with 16 Banshees, 42 Corsairs, and 26 A-1 Sky Raiders. Her flight and mechanical crews kept a high level of readiness on each class of her air wing. The only thing holding them down was the weather and a single accident with a faulty rocket. As described by a crew member who recalled, quote, "The main engine and boiler installation of the Leyte has worked without breakdown for over 2.5 years and 200,000 miles of steaming. By cautiously rotating between shifts of 4 to 6 of her 8 boiler rooms. All 8 were only lit when fleet exercises required full-speed runs. In the Sea of Japan, that just wasn't necessary. The crew meticulously reported every partial or significant design flaw, planning error, and mechanical advantage of everything from the bomb trolleys to the clipboards given to the pilots for mission briefing. Everything was run on tight planning and carefully coordinated, battling the weather, North Korea, and China. In adapting new technologies such as Mark V identify friendly or foe systems, and the Davis jet barriers, those being the nets erected across the deck when a plane needs to land with a broken or destroyed tailhook. And in each event that that system was used, no jets were significantly damaged upon landing. After this tour of Korea, Leyte returned to the United States in late January for overdue maintenance and rest for the crew. Most people don't consider it, but nonstop operations can't be continued without these maintenance stops, and she was visibly worn and tired from her winter campaign. However, during this time in the dry dock, she experienced her first honest disaster when machinery caught fire and exploded in the portside catapult room. 32 sailors and workers were killed, and many more were injured in what was still one of the worst fires on a U.S. naval carrier outside of war. When the damage was eventually patched, the proud but damaged carrier rejoined the fleet as an anti-submarine hunter. She loaded the first gunman S-2F tracker planes in 1955 for testing as a dedicated submarine hunter. These were some of the first planes in the American arsenal focused on detecting submarines and guiding Allied armed aircraft and destroyers to their location. She patrolled mostly in the North Atlantic and Mediterranean as a counter to the Soviet warships. While the exact details of how often she encountered the Soviet submarines on her patrols are unreported, she was said to have been extremely proficient at it. In 1958, she was awarded the Battle Proficiency Pennant after 3 years as a flagship of Carrier Division 18. This was unfortunately her final honor as an active warship. Leyte returned to the Brooklyn Navy Yard in January of 1959 for her decommissioning ceremony. On May the 15th, the proud leading lady, having steamed approximately 500,000 miles, in which she launched and recovered 70,000 planes, was finally retired. Honestly, after we researched the ship and read her combat logs, hearing stories of aviators and mechanics alike, there seems to be no better sign-off to the USS Leyte than the one offered to her by the U.S. Naval Institute. Some ships, for reasons not immediately evident, are chosen by fate to hold a unique significance among those that venture out to sea. This was the fate of the Leyte. From the moment she was commissioned until her final days in service, the ship and her crew were known for their unwavering commitment to serve with distinction, regardless of the assigned duty. Her crew always took pride in a very special manner, for they sensed, as I suspect only a sailor can, the flexibility, the preparedness, and the consistent ability to perform the impossible that constituted the character of the leading Leyte. Their spirit has become legendary, now that her active days are behind her, as the oldest Navy carrier in continuous active service. The retirement she enters is well deserved. However, it should be pointed out that the ship itself was entirely reduced to scrap, and nothing remains. And that is the story of the USS Leyte, but not the end of her reputation or her name. As much detail as I found during my research, it was only partway through that I remembered something far beyond the actions of any single man, and some of you might already know what I'm talking about. I'm referring to the story of Airmen Hunter and Brown. Well, I left something out. Brown wasn't just any aviator, but he was also the Navy's first African-American combat pilot. He joined the Navy as a reservist, enlisted in the Officer Training Corps, and worked his way up to flight school. After joining the Leyte, he said his shipmates treated him well, and he gained their trust and respect through skilled piloting that could well and beyond keep up with the rest of the air wing. When he crashed on December the 4th, Hunter went down with him, doing everything in his power to save his friend, packing the sides of Brown's downed Corsair with snow to limit the fire, and he kept him company until the helicopter arrived. He attempted to break Brown free with a crash axe, but unfortunately, he couldn't do enough to rescue his friend or recover his body. The Marines would ultimately recover his body sometime later during their strategic retreat and bury him with what honor they could at the reservoir. For his effort, Hunter was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor, while Brown was awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross and the Purple Heart. The story was further memorialized when, decades later, author Adam Makos wrote Devotion, an epic true story of heroism, brotherhood, and sacrifice in 2015. Hunter, still alive, signed many of the first edition books, which can still be found and collected today. Hunter actually returned to the chosen reservoir to find his friend's body and return him home. Now, although access was denied, allegedly, North Korean ruler Kim Jong-un was impressed by his boldness. In 2022, Devotion was adapted into a feature film starring Jonathan Majors and Glenn Powell. And so it was. Captain Thomas Hunter was honored with the Arleigh Burke-class destroyer launched in his name in 1991. While Jess Brown was honored posthumously with a Knox-class frigate bearing his name in 1975. However, this vessel was ultimately sold to Egypt in 1995. She's still serving in the Egyptian Navy to this very day. Meanwhile, a name as strong as the Leyte would not be lost forever, and the Ticonderoga-class cruiser Leyte Gulf was launched in 1985. Since then, USS Hunter has been on patrol in the Mediterranean and the Red Sea in the face of recent regional tensions, shooting down or disrupting several drones and missiles aimed at the ship, Israeli, and other international merchant ships. Leyte Gulf, for her part, even got an appearance in the blockbuster film Top Gun Maverick. These ships, their crews and their stories, they ring of two things, and two things most of all to me: devotion and dedication. They were dedicated men, every one of them doing their best to enhance each other and look out for the men on the ground and their fellow pilots in the air. And when they couldn't save one person at the moment, they always made the vow that they would come back. That is the spirit of a fine fighting ship. And special thanks to our sponsor. Download World of Warships by using my link in the description. Use the code WARSHIPS during registration to get exclusive rewards, including a bunch of doubloons, credits, premium account time, and a free ship after you complete 15 battles. And we'll leave it there for today, but I thank you for watching, and until next time, this is Ryan Socash, signing off.